The New York State's governor race this fall has garnered outsized national attention, partly because a well-known actress is mounting a left-wing challenge to the two-term Democratic incumbent, who just happens to be the son of a past governor, a one-time Kennedy family in-law, and a cabinet secretary during Bill Clinton's administration. Cynthia Nixon, who played Miranda on the long-running show Sex and the City, is an unrepentant progressive who has been attacking Andrew Cuomo hard from the left. She's pushing for a higher minimum wage, statewide rent subsidies, and massive tax funding for New York City's failing subway system. Her stances have won her the endorsement of The Nation, which credits her with pushing Cuomo to the left. But there's another candidate running for governor who's worth a longer look than either Nixon or Cuomo. The Libertarian Party candidate Larry Sharpe is a New York City native, former Marine, and an entrepreneur who came within 32 votes of being Gary Johnson's vice presidential candidate for the 2016 election. Even still, when Reason asked his rival Bill Weld how the LP could become more successful, Weld replied, "You want to get more candidates out like Larry Sharpe." Sharpe's vision for governing is both starkly realistic and relentlessly libertarian. Where most office seekers tap dance around questions of cutting spending and regulations, Sharpe doesn't miss a beat in laying out his platform, which is built around returning money and control to individual counties. As a black man who grew up under difficult circumstances in the Bronx and Queens, he insists that the libertarian message of ending the drug war, curbing over-policing, cutting occupational licensing, and expanding school choice can find a natural and big audience among minorities. In a wide-ranging conversation, Sharpe lays out his admittedly long-shot road to victory in November. He also talks about how his military experience and reading the 1970s classic self-help book, Looking Out for Number One, helped make him a better, more socially conscious individual. Larry, thanks for talking.
Glad to be here.
You are running for governor of New York State. Mm-hmm. Why?
It's a great question. New York State was ranked, if I remember right, 50th by Cato when it came to freedom. Bottom, we beat California. Yes, we are number one. We are the least free state in the union, and we beat California, and something has to change.
Why don't you just move that?
I could. That is an option. And people ask me, why are you running? Because I have two choices. Option one, leave the state that I love or fix it. So I'm trying to fix it. This is the time to do it. We have 100,000 New Yorkers leaving every single year. That's unsustainable. So many of us leave that we head down to Florida and to the Carolinas. So many of us go to the Carolinas, they actually have a name for us in the Carolinas. They call us halfbacks. We move to Florida and halfway back. That's how many of us leave. In fact, if you ever watch NFL games, you will find very often there are Buffalo Bills fans in almost every other stadium. These are all New Yorkers who've left. They're leaving our state like there's no tomorrow, and most from Western New York, Central New York, Northern country.
Yeah. I mean, downstate, the city itself and the Long Island or parts of Long Island and counties just north, they're doing pretty well. Upstate New York is like East Germany. What is, you say it's not a free state. What's at the top of your agenda in order to make it a better place?
There's so many things, but at its core, it's unfunded mandates. This is something almost no one talks about, but that's the core. The core actually is you have a lot of counties that literally have one third of their population on Medicaid, one third of their population on Medicare, and they have unfunded mandates that actually go to 80, 90, sometimes over 100% of their budget. It's unsustainable. With people leaving and the mandates remain the same, you simply can't pay for it. So the counties do one of two things. Number one, they decide to say, you know what? We have to raise property taxes because, by the way, there's a loophole in raising property taxes in New York State. There is, in theory, a 2% cap. But when it comes to property taxes, the people don't vote on that. Only local councils do. So they can go behind closed doors, declare an emergency, which it always happens to be an emergency, raise property taxes, and that now fills their mandates. Or they decide to use law enforcement as a profit center, which is a very common thing here in New York State now, right? That parking ticket that was $100, now it's $300. That speeding ticket that was $50 is now $500. And they wind up selling this off often. They don't even bother, if you don't notice, they don't even bother putting you in at court anymore. Instead, they will sell this off to a collection agency. The collection agency gives them a cut, maybe 30%, right, of the actual bill, and then they just destroy your credit. So they don't actually take you to court. They destroy your credit instead.
But and this is something that Andrew Cuomo, when he first came into office, he said, you know what, we can't tax our way out of this. New York is always
at the first, second, or third level, you know, pole position in combined state and local taxes.
Always.
So you got to cut spending. What are you cutting in that if you've got a third of the people on Medicaid, a third on Medicare, and the other getting
spending. It isn't just cutting. And that's what makes someone afraid. There's three things you want to do. You want to increase the tax base without increasing taxes, number one. Number two, you do want to cut spending, absolutely. And number three, you want to raise money other ways than through other ways other than taxation, right? So it isn't just cut spending. We want to cut spending. But if we just talk about cutting, everyone gets afraid. They say, oh my God, we're going to cut and I'm going to lose all my services. No, I'm not even going to cut personally. When you remove the unfunded mandates from the local counties, the counties will decide what they want to cut. They will decide.
But what do you mean by the unfunded mandates?
Right,
I mean,
now.
Because that's, I mean, isn't that healthcare costs? Isn't that?
All types of things, yes.
Yeah. But
healthcare,
I mean, that's
costs,
cutting spending.
MTA costs, all those things, yes. Tons of things we're spending money on. And we're saying you must spend money on it. And I'm saying, no. If your county and your local township, you want it, your local village wants it, please spend money on it. Keep your county the way you want to keep it. People tease me all the time and they say, Larry, you're born in Manhattan, you live in the Bronx and Queens. How can you know what's right for Broome County? How can you know what's right for Ontario County? How can you know? I don't. I don't pretend to know. And guess what? You up there, you don't know what's right for Queens either. So we're even. So how about instead a localized government and allow you to create your counties the way you want to create your counties, the way you want to create your local environment, right? If you remove the unfunded mandates, some people are going to keep a lot of what they like and some are not.
I want to hear what you have to say about the New York City subway system. It's got the worst on-time service. It is constantly broke. What happens?
How it's a disaster. It is embarrassingly bad. The MTA, we should be embarrassed by the MTA, and too many New Yorkers aren't. It is a total disaster. The average MTA employee makes about $118 an hour. And everyone is saying, how do we find more ways to fund the MTA? No. No more money to the MTA. Let me be very clear. No more money to the MTA. Their budget is their budget, period. They will fix it with that or they won't. And I'm okay with that. But Larry, the subways will collapse. They're already collapsing. When it rains in this city, we go from New York City to Mogadishu overnight. This is embarrassing. You can't get around anymore. No, our ideas instead have been, why don't we decide to tax taxis? Why don't we tax Uber? Why don't we tax? That's the same thing as saying, why don't we tax McDonald's to pay Burger King? That's what we're saying. No, I want to do two things. One, no more money to the MTA, fix it. If that means you collapse, if that means you go on strike, oh, well, you'll cut, you'll find a way. That's number one. But number two, the MTA is basically a situation where no one's in charge. This is very common in New York State. His Majesty Governor Cuomo has been very good in creating tons of committees and corporations and authorities where someone else is in charge. He appoints them, and then he gets money from those people, over $800,000 he received from people he's put on boards. Then they have crony capitalists, and that's why they go to jail and he doesn't. That's why after 7 years, he can just lament on how bad things are, even though he's been the governor.
Do you think New York will legalize recreational marijuana anytime soon?
If Governor Cuomo wins in November, no, he won't. He won't. He's happy with the way things are. He's not changing. And in reality, he wants to probably run for president. So he wants to make sure he maintains that balance of left and right. We need to totally deregulate both hemp and marijuana. Now, if people get afraid of that, fine. Here's what we do. For farmers, let's regulate hemp and marijuana like onions. Just like onions. Whatever the rules and regulations are for onions, that's the same for hemp and marijuana for farmers. Let farmers grow what they want to grow. Should farmers grow hemp and should they grow marijuana? I don't know. I'm not a farmer. Let's let them pick. Right now, they're struggling like there's no tomorrow. Give them an option. Let them grow what they want to grow.
Is marijuana legalization in New York, is it a left-right issue, or are people overwhelmingly in favor of it?
Most people are in favor of it, but if you talk to people who are more conservative, many of them are not. Mm-hmm. If you look at, in fact, look at it. Look at the people who are running, right? You look at the people on the right, they don't want to legalize it. They don't. Conservative Party does not want to legalize it, neither Republicans.
You mentioned winning. If
sure.
Andrew Cuomo wins, how can Larry Sharpe win?
Yeah, it's simpler than you would think. The reality of it is we're going to have at least a four-person race, maybe five or six. We have His Majesty King Cuomo. We have Howie Hawkins, the communist. We have the Republican sacrificial lamb. And we have myself. If Nixon stays in after she loses,
and that's Cynthia Nixon, the actress who was on Best Known for Sex in the City.
That's correct. If she stays in. And perhaps Minor, the former mayor of Syracuse, may also run. So we have at least four, maybe six. New York State is a plurality state. You just need more than the rest. You don't have to have 51%, right? More than the rest. If they have more in the case of four or five people, it's about 25% of the vote. Now, there are about 18, 19 million New Yorkers. Only about 4 million ever vote. That means there are 8 million who don't vote. So if 5 million vote, let's go high, I need 1.5 million votes, and I'm the governor. Gary Johnson got 175,000 votes in this state, and he was here for 5 minutes. I live in this state. I'm born in this state. I'm in events in this state every single week. I get people showing up at my events every single week, and I've raised more money than everybody except for Cuomo.
So what is the gap?
Cuomo is going to have probably $20 million total is my guess. Mm-hmm. He had 12 last time I checked, right? I'm at about $250,000, right? So if I do this right, I'll end up at the end with about $1 million. Mm-hmm. Now, if I get $1 million, if I raise $2 million, I'm the governor. I don't have to actually beat him. Max money doesn't always win. Here's how I win. There are, give or take, three types of people who will vote for me. Number one, those who have no hope. The four or five people who are running, they're just going to dig deep into the people who already vote. More conservative, more liberal. They're going to dive deep into those. They're not going to get anyone who has hope. These are all the old people. These people are all career politicians. They're not going to get anyone who has any hope. I'm the hope guy, right? Hope always wins. If the Democratic Party wasn't so broken, Bernie would have been their nominee in 2016 because he gave them hope. Trump gave the right hope, and hope won. And before that, Obama was hope. Hope won again. Hope wins often because hope gets people who don't vote out. The people who usually vote, they vote because of fear. The people who don't vote, they vote because of hope.
Where are you?
I will give them hope. They will come and show. How do I know that? Every event I go to, I ask this question. I say, hey guys, who here has not voted in the past two election cycles? Every single time, hands go up. I'm drawing in people who think, wait a minute, this is something new and different. There are 8 million people who don't vote. If I just get 10% of them, and just double Gary Johnson's numbers, I'm the governor. It can happen.
Who are your political heroes? You mentioned Gary Johnson before. He looms large in your pantheon.
Absolutely. I think he had the right answer using the veto. He had the right answer using governmental powers without overstepping, right? And he's the guy that I'm following. I'm following the guy who would decide on what enforcement is the right answer, on picking judges, on vetoing. I mean, he vetoed more than any of all the other governors combined. So yes, absolutely, someone like him is the right answer.
Who else? Because you're new to politics, you're new to the Libertarian Party, relatively speaking.
I've been in the party 6 years.
Yeah. Who else are your political heroes?
I look more at business leaders, to be fair with you. Mm-hmm. That's what I look at. I look more at. And the reason why, this is funny, there are so many Libertarians who say, I came here because of Harry Brown, or I came here because of Ron Paul, or I came here because of Gary Johnson, because I'm a business guy, it's who I am. So the person who I could hear was Gary Johnson, who was a business guy, right? He was an entrepreneur. So when he spoke, I could hear him.
The Libertarian Party, you've resigned recently from its national board?
I did.
Why did you do that, and is that failing?
This is a great question. I do think the LNC needs a lot. It needs an overhaul. I do believe that. But to be forward, the LNC has a right to be whatever it wants to be. I felt I didn't fit, so I left.
Wait, why did you quit, though? Was there a specific incident or
yes.
problem?
I've been very clear on how I felt about that. There were certain things that the LNC members mentioned, that talked about and supported, I did not support.
You're talking about Arvind Vora, and this is things like saying that, it's not such a bad idea to kill law enforcement people when you see them.
Things like that, things talking disparaging against teachers, against veterans. I am both a veteran and was a teacher, so I'm directly insulted.
So obviously, now that you're off the board, he can go back to doing whatever he was doing before insulting you. But
he's still on it.
No, I'm joking.
That's he's still on it, yes.
What does it say? Like, why should people in America, especially people who believe in libertarian values of free minds and free markets, of individual responsibility, of civility, of tolerance and pluralism, why should they invest themselves in a party like that?
It's a great question. And here's the reason why. As broken as the LP has been, and in certain cases still is, it is still without question the best vehicle for positive change in this country. It's not even close. There is no other vehicle there. I've joked and I've said sometimes it's a dumpster fire on wheels, but without it, we're walking. So I'll stay on it and I'll keep trying to put the fire out. because it is absolutely the best vehicle we have. There's no better vehicle, right? Democrats, Republicans, they're doing nothing. People say all the time, Larry, why don't you become like a Liberty Republican or something like that? I'm not a Republican, I'm Libertarian. And number two, what does that do? What change has occurred because of that?
The
answer is third party, break duopoly. The Libertarian Party is the right answer. As broken as it is, so what? Democratic Party's broken too, so is the Republican Party. They're all broken.
Why is the Libertarian Party and by extension the Libertarian movement so seemingly uniform in both the race, ethnicity, and gender of its people? It seems to be overwhelmingly a white male, middle to upper middle class, highly educated group of people. Why is that, and is that a problem?
Do you know who you're looking at?
Mm-hmm.
I don't fit that.
Yeah. That's one of the reasons we're talking to you.
I don't fit
you
that.
You know, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, I don't fit that. I don't think that's true.
Okay, so you don't think that the membership is overwhelmingly white and male?
No, I think the image is. And the image absolutely is, yes. The image is an image. Have you seen our vice chair?
Mm-hmm.
Nick is our chair. He's not wealthy.
Yeah.
Right? He's a regular everyday business guy. Right?
He's a used car salesman.
Yes, right. He runs a used car salesman. He's not wealthy. So he's a regular average everyday guy. So he's a white male, guilty as charged, but he's not wealthy. He's a regular guy.
Well, so is it a problem to be perceived
as
that? And why is it a problem? And do we address that?
100%, it absolutely is an issue that we deal with. But what should happen is more people should be highlighting the people who aren't.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Highlight me as you're doing now. Please keep doing that. Yes. Foxhole, who ran in Florida, right? We have lots of people who are not that. When Alex Merced, he's Hispanic, who ran here for Senate in New York State. So yes, we have tons of Aaron Comey who ran. I mean, people run all the time, and they're not white males. Happens all the time. We have enough people here.
Well, right? You know, the other thing is that you know, the votes that libertarians get seem to be, you know, pretty uniform as well. What is the libertarian message to women? What is the libertarian message to minorities? And you know, and obviously, Latinos, blacks, and other types of minorities have different concerns. But what's the epistles that you're sending their way?
Absolutely. Look, the first thing is we want to let people know that we're about equality. We were about marriage equality 40 years ago, right, before anyone else was on board. So what consenting adults want to do with other consenting adults is not our issue. Don't hurt other people, and we're good. So if you're part of the gay, lesbian, bi, if you're part of any gender or sexual minority, it doesn't matter. We're fine with that. So that's number one. We're good with that. No worries. Enjoy. So if you're part of any of those minorities, come on aboard. If you're part of Hispanic, black, poor minorities, right? If you're wealthy Hispanic, wealthy black, that's probably not a concern of yours. But if you're poor black, poor Hispanic, you know what you care about? Ending the drug war. How about end the drug war? We're the only party who wants to end the drug war. Right? People ask me all the time, Larry, you know, what's the biggest issue when it comes to race? Biggest issue, number one issue, war on drugs. Over anything else, war on drugs. It is the biggest issue that's crushed the black family for the past 30, 40 years. Without question, the biggest thing. But it also crushes poor whites, and it also crushes Hispanics also. Just a bigger chunk of the black community, without question. Who's gonna end the war on drugs? Only libertarians. Why wouldn't they wanna come here? But more importantly, how about licensing? You have people who, particularly in New York City, tons of women of color who want to start hair salons. They can't because of licensing. I'll ask you a very important question. What does a bureaucrat in Albany know about a black woman's hair? The answer, nothing. Not a thing. Let the people start their own businesses. When I was a kid in the Bronx, there were tons of people who are Hispanic and black who had their own businesses. That's gone away with licensing. They can't anymore. I knew guys who used to drive gypsy cabs back in the Bronx because the yellow cabs wouldn't come to the Bronx when I was a kid. So we need to end licensing.
Well, that's changed though right now. I mean, interestingly, not because of anything the government did, but because of Uber and Lyft.
That's correct.
And Roger.
Which we tried to fight Uber.
Right.
Which I would never fight Uber. We tried to fight Uber, and now we're trying to tax them out. Of course. Right? Uber allows people of color to take their car and make some money. So you want people to step up? I have an idea. Vote Libertarian.
Talk about your origin story, your conversion story. You grew up in a Democratic household.
I did.
And then you became a Libertarian over time.
Over time,
yeah.
Yes.
What happened?
Sure.
And is there something that other people can learn from your experience?
Yeah, I was raised in what you would assume the normal, you know, Bronx household, mother and father, both Democrats. And Democrats are good because they're Democrats. Republicans are evil because they're Republicans. There was no logic behind that whatsoever. But when I joined the military at 17, my first commander in chief was Ronald Reagan. And the Marine Corps, you may or may not know, is a very conservative branch compared to the others. So I think I kind of became more Republican as a young teen, 18, 19,
20. Why did you join the military? Why did you, and meaning you not only volunteered, but then within the service, you volunteered to be a Marine.
I did, yeah. Absolutely. Well, the funny thing is, I look back now when I know, right? Then I didn't know why I was doing it, but now it's obvious to me. My father died when I was a kid, 11 to 12 years old. He passed away. It was devastating to me, as it would for any child to lose his father. And my mother couldn't handle it. She was a disaster also. It totally broke her heart and crushed her. So she had a lot of issues. I had a lot of issues. I wanted to escape. I wanted to get out of here. I wanted to leave. And I was desperately searching for positive male role models. Again, then I didn't know that. Now, as I look back, it's 30 years ago. I can look back and know that's what I was doing. I was looking for positive male role models. And this is how I became a Marine. I was actually going to join the Army. My father was in the Army. I was going to join the Army, right? I'm going to follow my father's footsteps, join the Army. The Army recruiter brings me in. He says, hey, this is great. We're going to make you a general in 3 weeks, and you're going to be running everything, and everything's going to be awesome. And I thought, wow, this is great. This is back in the 80s, so I have the book covers and the bumper stickers going back to school, right? So I'm ready to go. So I'm out, excited, ready as I walk outside.
You were going to be all you could be.
I was going to be all I can be, absolutely. So as I walk outside, the Marine recruiter is right there, same building. He's standing with his arms crossed. And he says, hey, son, talk to the Army guy? I said, yeah. He said, you got a minute? I said, okay. So I went inside, he sat me down. He said, Army guy, he promised you a whole lot, didn't he? I said, yeah, it's great. I literally had the Army stuff in my hands, right? He goes, yeah, we call that the solar plan. Everything under the sun. And I went, he goes, you know what I'm gonna promise you? I said, what? He said, 4 hard years. You ready? I said, yes, sign right there. I threw the Army stuff right in the garbage. I signed right then and there. And I didn't know why I did that. I had no idea why. Now I look back, I was looking to learn how to be a man. I wanted someone to say, be a man. I didn't have a father figure.
So that brought you from being a Democrat to kind of being a Republican.
Yeah,
and then, you know, what happened when you got past being a man and being a human? Or
yes.
How did you end up as a libertarian?
Then after that, I actually became disenchanted. I thought that maybe Bill Clinton was going to be different, right? He's a different kind of a Democrat. So now I kind of ship him more towards Democrat. Maybe he'll be the guy who do it. I only voted in presidential elections because I was overseas most of the time. I voted by mail. So local elections, I didn't vote until I was, I don't know, in my 20s, late 20s, before I voted in local elections. So all elections were only the presidential elections from overseas by mail-in ballot. And so I voted for Clinton, and they realized he's nothing, so I didn't want to vote again. I voted for Perot, I think, after that. I was anybody who wasn't them. Hmm. So I voted for Perot after that. And then I supported Nader, who was a third-party guy also. So I supported everybody who wasn't the R's and the D's. And to be full with you, at that time, I couldn't have told you what their policies were. I wouldn't have known. I didn't know what a Reform Party guy was. I didn't know what a Green Party guy was. I knew they weren't the R's and the D's. So I was kind of disenchanted. And I actually wasn't going to vote again until Obama came out. And I thought, oh, because I had been a Perot-Nader guy. And then Obama came out. I thought, okay, this guy's got to be different. I mean, he's physically different. He's black. He's from a city. He's like me. This guy's going to get it. So I voted Obama. And he was Bush Jr. And I thought, no difference there either. Again, disenchanted. And I wasn't going to vote in 2012. I was finished voting. Again, I almost didn't vote in 2008. I was not going to vote in 2012. Then I heard Gary Johnson speak. And when Gary Johnson spoke, things landed for me. And I think they did because, as you and I were speaking earlier, I'm a fan of Robert Ringer. Robert Ringer is a business guru who, me as a business consultant.
Wrote one of the iconic classic self-help books of the 1970s,
absolutely.
Looking Out for Number One.
Yeah. And To Be or Not to Be Intimidated, mm-hmm. Action, Nothing Happens Until Someone Moves, all these different, I've read all his books. Big fan. He's an Ayn Rander, objectivist. I didn't even know what that was, but he recommended reading Atlas Shrugged. So I did.
How did you meet him?
I didn't meet him.
Oh, okay. You just read him.
Yep. I've never met him.
Okay.
I read him. Been part of his blogs, things of that sort, right? So then I read Ayn Rand because he said so. I thought, nice, I get it. So I kind of had the ideas. But I never considered myself an objectivist. But I understood his concepts and ideas behind it. So then when Gary Johnson spoke, I think I was ripe to hear it. He was an entrepreneur like I was. What he said resonated with me. So I could hear it. I said, this guy's different. And when that happened, I began to follow Gary Johnson. I actually came to a Libertarian Party event, and I became a Libertarian. I joined the party in 2012 because of Gary Johnson. I followed his campaign then. And I followed his campaign in 2016, and I'm still a big fan.
Does it give you pause that he only got 3% and change of the 2016 vote?
Yeah, it wasn't the best campaign, but there's a big but here. It was the best we've ever had. He set us up for the future, and we are bigger and badder and stronger than we've ever been. thanks to what he's done. So I'm happy he did it. Do I wish we had more? Of course. I wish he was president right now. If I had a choice, I wish he was our president right now. There's no question we'd be doing better off than we are now. So I wish he was our president. But he's not. I accept it. I'm glad with what he did. I'm going to take the ball even further.
Yeah. Well, we're going to leave it there. We have been talking with Larry Sharpe. He is the Libertarian Party gubernatorial candidate for the state of New York. Larry, thanks for talking to Reason.
Thanks for having me.
For Reason, I'm Nick Gillespie.